How does a planet become habitable? How do we go from a randomly clumping cloud of dirt and gas to a world a sentient being can call home? We're so used to living in our relative paradise that we're taking for granted how exceptional our situation actually is. Not any of our close neighbors had what it took to lead to a biosphere like ours. Looking further beyond our solar system, it has proven to be extraordinarily hard to find any exoplanets that even approach our own home world, the Earth. If we are to have any hope of finding life elsewhere or finding new places to call home, we'd have to understand how other worlds are shaped. So what does it take to forge a biosphere out of interstellar molecular clouds? Is the path towards a life-bearing world wide with many alternative routes, or actually quite narrow? Let's try to find out. The habitable zone is generally used as an indicator for the potential presence of life, but it's important to remember that it merely denotes the region where we'd expect the presence of liquid water. It may be a good indication of the presence of any sort of life, but when it comes to the sort of life we're really interested in, that is, complex and macroscopic, we need to narrow things down. So what kind of worlds would that be? Well, first of all, the kind that we know with absolute certainty can support life, namely the kind of world we live on. A celestial body similar enough to Earth in composition, size and environment to be conducive to the evolution of carbon-based and water-dependent life. This means it has to be a so-called terrestrial planet, mostly made of silicate with a large iron core and covered by oceans of water, though not to the point of being a water world. The planet must have a dynamic geology with volcanism and tectonics for maintaining a climatic equilibrium by recycling minerals and especially carbon. This means that the world must be above a certain size to sustain internal heat and geological activity, and ideally have relatively shallow seas and even dry land to allow for weathering and the cycling of essential elements. On water worlds, these processes would not be possible, and the lack of dissolved minerals may well be the limiting factor for the development of any complex life. It must also not orbit an M-type star, a so-called red dwarf, many times smaller than our Sun. These worlds are what I termed erythrogean in the previous video of this series. And although several have been detected now so far, we have no idea whether any of them are truly habitable. There are in fact many reasons to believe that this class of worlds are actually not viable, or not for complex life in any case. An often cited factor is the violent temper of these stars, at least in their early years. During this period, they emit intense solar flares and coronal mass ejections, which can strip away any planetary atmospheres and irradiate the surface. Then there is the issue that any habitable zone planets will end up being tidally locked, with one side permanently facing the star and the other remaining in eternal darkness. The consequences of this are unpredictable and not well understood, but would likely yield a radically different environment from what we're used to. The potentially extreme temperature gradients and unstable weather patterns may not be very conducive for life after all. Another factor is that the light frequencies these stars emit are not effective enough to break down carbon monoxide in planetary atmospheres due to a lack of sufficient ultraviolet radiation. This would prevent the buildup of oxygen, which in turn would quell any attempts at evolving macroscopic active life forms that would require oxygen for their high energy needs. So when imagining an Earth analog, we likely need to limit ourselves to a yellow star like our Sun or something very close. These kinds of main sequence stars have the right amount of ultraviolet light for photolysis of carbon dioxide and methane, are relatively stable over long periods, and do not tidally lock planets in their habitable zones. We may still have a wide margin with that, however, because any high-end K-type star or orange dwarf might also be suitable, and perhaps even more so than our Sun. The same goes for a low-end F-type star, as long as they're not too hot and bright. These would emit slightly different wavelengths of light, yet still be friendly enough for life as we know it. So perhaps it could be useful to distinguish three subtypes of worlds. Chlorogean, bathing in yellow light, like our suns, peaking at green spectra. Xanthogean, receiving yellow-orange light. And cyanogean, receiving yellow-white light. This would then also hint at the optimal plant pigments on these worlds being greenish, yellowish, and bluish respectively. The creation of a biogenic world can very aptly be described as the baking of a cake. It all comes down to ingredients and the external processes we subject it to. The ingredients needed for life as we know it can be summarized with the following mnemonic. Sponge. That is, sulfur, phosphor, oxygen, nitrogen, carbon, and hydrogen. And these happen to be some of the most common in our universe. Although, phosphor is actually the rarest element of the six. From these basic atomic elements, you'd very quickly get the simplest molecules that nevertheless already hold a lot of promise. Some will already be able to exist into their pure molecular forms, usually as paired atoms like hydrogen, oxygen, and nitrogen. But they can also react with each other into a myriad of simple molecules. Atoms binding with oxygen are formed in a process called oxidation. Well-known occurrences are carbon monoxide and carbon dioxide, or CO2. Nitrous oxide, or N2O, also known as laughing gas. Sulfur dioxide, or SO2. Phosphorus monoxide, PO. Atoms binding with hydrogen are formed in a process called reduction, leading to combinations hydrogen sulfide, or H2S, which smells like rotten eggs. Hydrogen nitride, or NH3, better known as ammonia. Hydrogen phosphide, or PH3, better known as phosphine. The latter substance has made headlines as potentially being detected on Venus as a possible sign of life. Carbon tetrahydride, better known as methane. Most importantly, there's hydrogen and oxygen combining together into what's formerly known as dihydrogen monoxide, better known as water. There are many other combinations possible and even larger molecules, but not all combinations are equally stable and will tend to disappear unless they're regularly generated or shielded from cosmic forces like radiation. Radiation can be both destructive and creative, adding energy for generating even more complex molecules in the process. Whether a molecule ends up oxidized or reduced depends largely on where it forms. In the outer layers of interstellar molecular clouds, exposed to starlight and high energy radiation, oxygen is abundant and eager to bond, which favors oxidation. But deeper inside, where starlight barely reaches and hydrogen flows freely, it's the reductive reactions that tend to take over. These sheltered regions are colder, quieter, and full of dust grains, where atoms can slowly piece themselves together into something more elaborate. Through the discipline of astrochemistry that aims to study what chemical elements occur in space by analyzing light emissions, we have detected almost 300 molecular combinations. It turns out that many of the compounds needed for life are formed long before the planet in question or even its solar system is formed, namely in the early star-forming clouds themselves. Notable examples of these are glycolaldehyde and methyl isocyanate. Glycolaldehyde is a sugar-like molecule that is two steps away from a building block of RNA. Methyl isocyanate is the simplest molecule with a structure similar to a peptide bond and thus may be a precursor to amino acids, which are what proteins are made of. On asteroids, including samples from the 2023 Ryugu mission, we've actually found amino acids and even uracil, one of RNA's base monomers. So clearly, many of the precursors for life are ready to seed any newly forming worlds. having the right ingredients is only half the recipe. The proportions matter too. Too much water and you might get a planet-wide ocean with no continents. No dry land, no plate tectonics, and nowhere for complex chemistry to concentrate. Too much methane could suppress the buildup of oxygen and push the planet into a runaway greenhouse effect. Too much carbon wouldn't just displace oxygen and with it water, but could build a surface of graphite and carbide instead of rock, and oceans rich in hydrocarbons, suffocating any interesting dynamics. And too little phosphorus? Life might never gain a foothold at all. But perhaps life could still take a hold, as long as there's enough carbon to go around. And as it turns out, that would not even be a given for a planet like Earth. Carbonaceous bodies like asteroids and planetesimals don't normally form in the inner part of a solar system, but only beyond the frost line where all the gas and ice giants develop. It was only because of a tug of war between early Jupiter and Saturn that billions of carbonaceous bodies were swept towards the Earth. And according to a recent study, Theia, the large object that created the Moon when it collided with the forming Earth, may have been carbon-rich itself. Without it, Earth may have remained a sterile frozen rock, not unlike Mars. Now, some of you might say that this approach is a bit too narrow. After all, life could, in theory, develop in radically different environments and be based on wholly different kinds of chemistry. And for the record, I'm not discounting the possibility of alternative biospheres. But the life that developed on Earth is still the only kind we know for sure exists. And for all we know, it might even be the only kind that's really possible. Earth-like planets may turn out to be exceedingly rare simply because of how many things can go awry. So for the purpose of this video series, we'll start within these bounds and see just how far our speculations can go, even within this narrow wiggle room. But what do you think? Might worlds with weird chemistries still turn out to be viable? Could different gravitational regimes make for some interesting geochemical effects? Let us know in the comments and I'll take a look at it. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up and maybe even a sub if you haven't already. Thanks for sticking around. Until next time, stay sharp and stay evolved.